remember, in our study, we're going to be looking at the Book of Revelation from the futurist standpoint, i.e. that the Book of Revelation is about a sequence of events that has not yet occurred, or at least from chapter 4 onward. Now, are there going to be places from chapter 4 onwards that don't seem to be part of that progression? Yes. Are there going to be chapters in Revelation that seem to be about the Romans getting theirs? Yeah. But in general, my view is that the Book of Revelation is about the end times. So if you view it that way, here's the sequence of events we're going to be talking about. And this is you could start with chapter 4 or chapter 5. Chapter 4 is kind of a scene in heaven, God's on his throne, you know, the 24 elders are worshiping him, all that. So the end times events probably really starts with chapter 5. The opening of the scroll with seven seals by the Lion of Judah. And that's what kicks off the whole sequence of events that happens in Revelation. And it's such a wonderful chapter because it describes everyone in heaven. Oh, the scroll needs to be opened, but is there anyone worthy enough to open the scroll? And they're all running around, hitting their foreheads. We have to find somebody who's worthy to open the scroll. And then they remember, the Lamb of God. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. That's where that wonderful hymn comes from. It comes straight out of the fifth chapter of Revelation. Christ is worthy enough to open the scrolls. So by opening up the scrolls with the has seven seals on it, this kicks off the whole sequence of events in Revelation. The first thing that happens, and I'm talking in broad terms, and I know there are side lights to this. God causes a time of tribulation on earth. Terrible things are going to happen. Number two, halfway through the tribulation, God sends two witnesses to prophesy to mankind. And for people who are living, this is kind of the last chance. This is what Annette was saying a moment ago. So the two prophets are probably either Moses and Elijah, or it's Enoch and Elijah. Two of the most prominent people from the Old Testament are the two witnesses. The reason Enoch and Elijah is interesting is they're the only two people in the Old Testament who didn't die. They're both sent up. They were pulled up to heaven. So the two witnesses come and they preach to mankind. It's like they're giving mankind the last chance. And what does mankind do? Does mankind welcome them and fall down on their faces to worship God? No, mankind kills them. They kill the two witnesses. So from that point on, Satan takes control. Satan and his forces fight back and take over the earth. And Satan does this with the beast from the sea and the beast from the earth, which I would also call the Antichrist and the false prophet. Satan seems to put a human being into a place of political power, and also a false prophet into a place of religious power. And it is these two people who rule in Satan's name. Christ returns and defeats the earthly powers in the Battle of Armageddon. Now, Christ returning is pretty clear in the Book of Revelation. I don't think you can argue that one. Whether or not that is the same as the Battle of Armageddon, we can have a discussion about that, because Battle of Armageddon is actually never described as occurring. It tells us that all of the forces of this world all meet together at a place called the Hill of Megiddo. And you're thinking, this is it, the final battle. And then that's it, it doesn't talk about it anymore. It doesn't talk about the battle occurring. So I'm using interpretation to say that the Battle of Armageddon is the final battle that is fought when Christ returns. After Christ returns, Satan is bound in the abyss for 1,000 years. If you are a premillennialist, as I am, then you believe that there will be 1,000-year rule of Christ and the martyrs. Why is there this 1,000-year period? It's kind of give the martyrs a special place to rule with Christ. The martyrs are the people who have died in the name of Christ. 1,000 years is over, Satan is released. And Satan fights one more battle. And what's the name of that battle? Anybody know? We talked about it last week. Gog and Magog. That's when that finally comes in. The final battle with Satan. Well, this time, this one's easy. There's not even a big deal about it. Satan is defeated and consigned to hell, consigned to the lake of burning fire. Then we're told there's a new heaven, a new earth, and a new Jerusalem. And we're told that as part of that, God is going to be with his creation, be with his people. There's no need for a temple in a new heaven, a new earth, and a new Jerusalem, because God is with us all the time. Just like it was back in the Garden of Eden before our wayward parents messed everything up. And then God reigns eternally. So that's the sequence we're going to be examining Revelation from. Now, is the sequence clear cut? No. Are there strange interludes that go off in different places along the way? Yeah. Is there room for other interpretations of the book of Revelation than this one? Yeah. We talked about that, remember, the four interpretations. But you can find this sequence in the book of Revelation, and it's a sequence that leads up to the second coming of Christ and a new heaven, a new earth, and a new Jerusalem. And that will be the focal point of our discussion.